Of the Pierre Fort Pierre Ministerial Association, followed by the Pages, who will be doing the Pledge of Allegiance. It's Ashlyn Simons of Union Center and Mark Smith of Faith.
Let us pray. Almighty God, ruler of the universe and Lord of hosts, as creator, you have given us this good land as our heritage. Grant that we remember your generosity and constantly do your will. Bless our great state with honest industry, truthful education, and an honorable way of life. Save us from violence, discord, and confusion, from pride and arrogance, and from every evil course of action. Grant that we, who came from many nations with many different languages, may become a united people. Support us in defending our liberties, and give those to whom we have entrusted the authority of government the spirit of wisdom, that there may be justice and peace in our land. When times are prosperous, may our hearts be thankful, and in troubled times, do not let our trust in you fail. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
I
pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. Today we have a special presentation today from Sammy Gortmaker. You might recognize the last name. Sammy Gortmaker is the daughter of Brian Gortmaker, the head of the DCI, and she is going to sing for us today the national anthem. So if you'd please rise.
say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming? Whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming? And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
I'm sure she made her dad very proud. The clerk will call the roll.
Allers, Anderson, Bartles, Barthel, Bartling, Beal, Bordeaux, Bruner, Campbell, Carson, Chase, Clark, Consett, Denner, Dietrich, DeSanto, Duvall, Freimuller, Glanzer, Goodwin, Gosch, Greenfield, Lana, Haugard, Hawley, Heinemann, Holmes, Howard, Hunhoff, Jameson, Jensen, Johns, Johnson, Kaiser, Carr, Catwick, Blake, Latterell, Lesmeister, Levermont, Lust, Marty, May, McCleary, McPherson, Mills, Ott, and Herman, Peterson, Camp, Peterson, Sue, Pishke, Quam, Rasmussen, Reed, Roden, Ring, Rounds, Rosum, Schaefer, Shane, Fish, Smith, Soli, Steinhauer, Stevens, Tolson, Turbeville, Wheezy, Willidson, Wismer, York, Zickman, Mickelson. Mr. Speaker, there's a quorum present.
Thank you very much. Approval of the journal.
Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Legislative Procedures respectfully reports that the Chief Clerk of the House has had under consideration the House Journal of the 14th day. All errors, typographical or otherwise, are duly marked in the temporary journal for correction, and we hereby move the adoption of the report. Respectfully submitted, G. Mark Mickelson, Chair.
Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Journal is approved. Communications. Reports of standing committees.
The Committee on Retirement Laws respectfully reports that Senate Bills 35, 36, 37, 38 do pass and be placed on the consent calendar. Respectfully submitted, Hugh M. Bartles, Chair. The Committee on Health and Human Services respectfully reports that Senate Bill 30 and 71 do pass and be placed on the consent calendar, and House Bill 1205 do pass as amended. Respectfully submitted, Wayne H. Steinhauer, Chair. The Committee on Agriculture and Natural Resources respectfully reports that House Bill 1214 and 1217 do pass and be placed on the consent calendar. House Bill 1156 was deferred to the 41st legislative day. Respectfully submitted, Thomas Bruner, Vice Chair. The Joint Committee on Appropriations respectfully reports that House Bill 1060, 1061, 1062, 1065, and 1071 do pass. Senate Bill 1043 do pass as amended. Respectfully submitted, David L. Anderson, Co-Chair. The Committee on Local Government respectfully reports that House Bill 1074 do pass and be placed on the consent calendar. House Bill 1119 do pass as amended and be placed on the consent calendar. House Bill 1141 and 1142 were deferred to the 41st legislative day. Respectfully submitted, Bert Tolson, Vice Chair. And the Committee on Transportation respectfully reports that House Bill 1190 do pass, 1179 do pass as amended, 1195 do pass as amended, HCR 1004 resolution be adopted. Respectfully submitted, Mary Duvall, Chair. Also, Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that the Office of Engrossing and Enrolling has carefully compared House Bill 1034 and finds the same correctly enrolled. Respectfully submitted, G. Mark Mickelson, Chair.
Messages.
Mr. Speaker, I have the honor to return here with House Bill 1034, which has passed the Senate without change. Respectfully, Kay Johnson, Secretary. Also, Mr. Speaker, I have the honor to return here with HCR 1005, in which the Senate has concurred. Respectfully, Kay Johnson, Secretary. Also, Mr. Speaker, I have the honor to transmit herewith Senate Bills number 46, 61, 80, and 89, which have passed the Senate, and your favorable consideration is respectfully requested. Respectfully, Kay Johnson, Secretary.
Representative Rounds.
Personal privilege.
Granted.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, today's a very special day in the number of years I've been here. It's always one I look forward to, and the main reason is the introductions we will have today. A lot of the loved ones of members of the body are here today. Many of them went and had a good lunch today at the governor's mansion, and it's going to culminate this evening. And this evening, we are going to have that opportunity as members of the legislature to say thank you to the best of the best, and that would be our South Dakota National Guard. And with this, I want to remind everybody, if you don't plan on going or if you don't know yet, please make it an attempt to be there. In just a second or two, you're going to hear the proof as to why they are the best of the best. And with that, I'm going to defer the rest of my time to the good representative from Pennington County. Thank you.
Representative Campbell.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and ladies and gentlemen of the House, and honored guests. This legislature expresses its respect, commendation, and congratulations to South Dakota National Guard units, beginning with Detachment 1, Company B, 1st 112th Aviation Battalion of Rapid City, South Dakota, being awarded the Certificate of Victory by the National Guard Association of the United States. Also, South Dakota National Guard's 155th Engineer Company, located in Rapid City and Wagner, South Dakota, awarded the Itchner Award and the Reserve Family Readiness Award. And finally, for my part in this, the entire South Dakota Army National Guard, on being elected as the overall winner in the 2017 Army Communities of Excellence Awards. And I will defer my time to my seatmate, the good representative from Lincoln and Minnehaha counties.
Representative Jameson.
Thank you. I'd like to recognize the South Dakota Air National Guard 114th Fighter Wing on being awarded the Distinguished Flying Unit Plaque, as well as the Air Force Outstanding Unit Award. And now I'll yield my time to the good representative from Custer, Fall River, and Pennington.
Representative Goodwin.
Thank you. I would like to recognize three senior officials from the country of Suriname, South America, that are training and partnering with the South Dakota National Guard. They are gonna stand right up here to the front. Can you stand up, gentlemen? The South Dakota National Guard and the country of Suriname have been partners in the support of the state partnership program since June of 2006. The state's partnership program creates opportunities to enhance each other's organization and foster enduring relationships. Today we have Lieutenant Colonel Michael Ladobi, Acting Director of the Minister of Defense, Lieutenant Colonel John Antonius, Head Department of Strategic Planning and Education, and Lieutenant Colonel Harry Van Don Jen, Commander of the Suriname Army. Let's give them all a big South Dakota welcome.
Please welcome them.
I will be followed by the distinguished representative from Connington and Dual County.
Thank you.
Representative Kettwig.
It's my pleasure to introduce the three South Dakota, or some members of a team that I've been a part of for the last 23 years. The Deputy Secretary of the Department of the Army, Mr. Steve Harding. The Lieutenant Commander Travis Irvin, a member of the United States Navy stationed down in Suriname. Captain Betsy Sir and Captain Wayne Skelton, two South Dakota Guardsmen that are involved in the Suriname Partnership Program here in the States and in Suriname. So please help me welcome those.
Thank you very much to the representatives from Suriname and also the individuals who are serving here and the relationship to that country. We thank you very much for your service, and thanks very much to the gentlemen here who have provided the introductions too. Motions and resolutions.
House Concurrent Resolution Number 1006, commemorating the life of George Speaker Mickelson and calling for a bust of Mickelson to be displayed in the lobby of the State House of Representatives.
Representative Qualm.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I will read the resolution. A concurrent resolution commemorating the life of George Speaker Mickelson and calling for a bust of Mickelson to be displayed in the lobby of the State House of Representatives. Whereas George Speaker Mickelson, a son of Selby, was born during the 1941 session of the South Dakota State Legislature, during which his father, George T. Mickelson, served as Speaker of the House, and at the urging of House members was given the middle name Speaker to recognize his father's position. And whereas Mickelson attended the University of South Dakota and served in the United States Army, and in 1963, he married Linda McCarron, and together they raised three children, Mark, Amy, and David, making their home in Brookings. And whereas Mickelson served as Assistant Attorney General and as Brookings County State's Attorney, and was elected to the State House of Representatives in 1974, and served as Speaker of the House in 1977 and 1978. And whereas in 1986, Mickelson was elected the 28th governor of South Dakota, and as governor, he reinvented the state's economic development and tourism promotion efforts, declared a year of reconciliation among peoples of all races, and led the celebration of the state centennial. And whereas Mickelson and seven others died in a crash of the state airplane on April 19, 1993, and South Dakota will commemorate the 25th anniversary of Mickelson's death in 2018, and whereas, as a Speaker of the House, son of a Speaker of the House, father of a Speaker of the House, distinguished state representative, and governor, it is fitting and proper for the South Dakota State Legislature to memorialize Mickelson. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the House of Representatives of the 93rd Legislature of the State of South Dakota, the Senate concurring therein, that the South Dakota Legislature calls on all South Dakotans to give thanks for the life and service of George S. Mickelson, and be it further resolved that the House of Representatives, the Senate concurring therein, calls on the South Dakota Arts Council to obtain a bust of George Speaker Mickelson to be displayed in his memory in the lobby of the House of Representatives. Just a little more information, James Michael Maher, he sculpted several of the statues outside, including the ones of Norbeck, Rounds, and the Mickelson statues, is the one that is doing the bust. It will be at a cost of $12,500, all donated funds, and so there will be no tax dollars involved. I had the privilege to know the governor. I was president of the corn growers at the time, and we had several meetings. We were working to get the checkoff started. We were working to get some of the ethanol stuff going, and I enjoyed every minute this was with him. He was a great man and very deserving of this honor. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Representative Qualm moved that House Concurrent Resolution 1006, as found on page 244 of the House Journal, be adopted.
Thank you for the comments on the resolution. Any further comments? I certainly appreciate the fact that we've recognized Governor Mickelson over the years and in many ways, and these are appropriate symbols of recognition. This is an appropriate thing to have within the House of Representatives. Obviously, it meant a lot to your Speaker Mickelson. It meant a lot to your family over the years that even your father's middle name is Speaker. So important recognition and an appropriate recognition. And that was a sad day for everyone in the state. Hearing no further comments, the resolution is to adopt the resolution commemorating, the vote will be to commemorate the life of George Speaker Mickelson, calling for a bust of Mickelson to be displayed in the lobby of the State House of Representatives. All those in favor will indicate with a yes vote, and the clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Representatives Hunhoff and Mills. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were yeas 67, excused 3.
House Concurrent Resolution 1006, having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Mr. Speaker.
Personal privilege?
Granted.
I've got two. The first is we still do get a little emotional, so thank you. But what I really meant to tell you was what happened, according to this, and he was from Selby, where in Mobridge, where Representative Gosch is from. And he married a wonderful woman. Her maiden name was Turner. This is my grandfather, George. And so he was, this is 1941, and they had three girls, and so they finally had their boy, which was my father. And so the House passed a resolution saying, no, the boy shall be named Speaker. And it got vetoed by Madge, his grandma. So it's the only time that's probably ever happened. But she said, she consented, relented, and said his middle name can be Speaker. And so he was always George to when I was a child. But his family, his sisters, those that knew him as a young man, called him Speak. Called him Speaker, Speak. They would talk about him. That's just how he went because his father was George. So it's just kind of interesting. And I appreciate this is a very nice recognition, and I appreciate it. And I have a second personal privilege, if I could, which is I have a constituent here who has been recognized as running, being one of the very best at her profession in the country, and she moved here from Michigan, and you guys all decided that she was worth it. We recruited someone very good to come run our medical school. And her name is Mary Nettleton, and she's in the audience right here. Would you please join me in welcoming Dean Nettleton, and then all the individuals in the white coats are the first-year medical students down at USD, and we really have a first-class med school. So, Dean Nettleton, how many first-year students do you have?
71.
So please welcome them here to the gallery today.
And along that same line, as long as we're recognizing medical students and doctors, Dr. Lou Huber of Sioux Falls is here, seated toward the back. And if you'd stand, please, she is the Doctor of the Day, sponsored by the South Dakota State Medical Association. Dr. Huber graduated from medical school in 1998 in China, completed an internal medicine residency at the University of South Dakota in 2009, and nephrology fellowship from the University of Vermont in 2011. Dr. Huber was a faculty member of the Medical School of Georgia before joining Avera Health in September of 2016, and Dr. Huber is a member of the South Dakota State Medical Association. Thanks very much for being here today.
Senate Concurrent Resolution Number 6, recognizing the 70th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights on December 10th, 2018, and the celebration of Human Rights Day. Representative Ahlers moved that Senate Concurrent Resolution 6, as found on page 221 of the Senate Journal, be adopted as amended on page 267 of the Senate Journal.
Senate Concurrent Resolution Number 6. Having had its reading, is up for consideration. Final passage, are there any remarks? Representative Ahlers.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, this December will mark the 70th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights that was signed by the United Nations in 1948. It's the awareness that human rights and the realization of all of us are entitled to fundamental freedoms in this world. This declaration encapsulates the values of our democratic republic and emulate our beliefs found in the Declaration of Independence and our Constitution. It states that unequivocally that all human beings are born free, that no person ought to be deprived of their freedom. The right to life, liberty, and the security of person are guaranteed to all, and declares that the will of the people is the basis for the authority in government. The Universal Declaration affirms the values that our founders held dear. Just as our founders created the Constitution to defend these rights, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights works to secure these rights for individuals all around the world. The Universal Declaration also supports our South Dakota values and declares that family is the natural and fundamental unit of society. We as South Dakotans value family as an economic and social unit, and we recognize that families act as essential support systems for our leaders of tomorrow. For the last 7 years in Sioux Falls, students have learned about the Declaration of Human Rights and have had the opportunity to express their thoughts in writing in the Human Rights Day essay contest for 7th and 8th graders. This essay contest is sponsored by over a dozen civic organizations. The contest has led to many discussions in classrooms and around dinner tables, and at this time I'd like to congratulate all the young writers who have participated in this contest. And I especially like to offer my congratulations to this past year's winning authors, 7th graders Micaiah Bushman, Bella Martinez, Shafir Pervez, and 8th graders Patrick Vogel, Annika Jacobson, and Davis Schaefer. In conclusion, I'd like to reflect on the remarks that Ronald Reagan made as he signed the Human Rights Day, Bill of Rights Day, and Human Rights Week Proclamation. The Universal Declaration of Rights, a triumph for the higher aspirations of mankind, is but words on paper unless we are willing to act to see that it is taken seriously. We owe it to ourselves and to those who have sacrificed so much for our liberty to keep America in the forefront of this battle. Thank you.
Representative Kaiser.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm going to ask for some no votes on this. The prior speaker did a very, very good job framing the debate on this and making sure all the comments were, should we say, right-leaning. A few of the things that the human rights, well, first of all, the Human Rights Declaration is brought to you from the United Nations. A group that in 2016 themselves had reported 41 different cases of sexual assault by their UN peacekeeping troops in countries in Cambodia, Congo, Haiti, Libya. In 2017, the New York Times reported similar sex crimes by the UN peacekeeping troops in Uganda. Interesting note, the UN troops have legal immunity in the countries where they commit these atrocities. Now, when we're talking specific about this resolution and the Universal Declaration, I'll get to the declaration in a second, but we have a lot of contradictions within this resolution. For instance, on page 1, line 9, whereas the legislature supports the ideas of human rights, encourages all nations to continue working towards freedom, peace, and security, which can be achieved through democracy, respect with human rights, and the rule of law. Every single country on the face of the planet that has ever been a democracy has turned into a totalitarian state or an oligarchy. We are a constitutional republic. The term democracy and rule of law are contradictory. Democracy is 51% of the people getting to vote away the rights of 49% of the people. That's why in our constitutional republic, we have a rule of law. We don't allow 51% to vote away the rights of the other 49%. This group, this resolution, is against the ideals of the republic. This group, this institution, does want a democracy. This group does not want to protect your rights. If they did, they would speak of a constitutional republic and the American way of life. Now, a few of the quote-unquote rights outlined in the Declaration of Human Rights is you have the right to Social Security and are entitled to economic, social, and cultural help from your government. In other words, your government gets to take from somebody else and give to you. Obviously contradictory to the word freedom when you're talking about personal property and what you get to keep, what you've earned. Workers' rights. Every adult has a right to a job. The government now is going to give you a job, a fair wage, and to join a trade union. You have the right to leisure and rest from work. I'm assuming the government's going to step in and tell you how many vacation days you get. So as a private employer, if you want to give more, too bad. Government says this is the way it is. Everyone has the right to a standard of living for themselves and their family. You are entitled to social order so we can enjoy these rights. So a lot of this is up to speculation as what do these terms mean? What is social order? Yes, I don't know. But I do know that this is entirely un-American. And I will ask you to vote no on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative. Any further remarks? Representative Rosem.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Even though I agree with the mission of promoting human dignity and justice and peace, I would suggest that everybody go to the website, which I did, and it's in the back of the little booklet that we received, HREUSA.org. You will see the 2017 Strategic Operating Plan. You will see the 10-year vision, the 5-year goals, all the way down to what the external threats are today. And you may end up agreeing with all of those, but before you cast a vote, I would definitely suggest that you have a look at that to make sure that you are in agreement. On the surface, this seems pretty innocuous, but once you delve into it a little bit, I do begin to wonder. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Further remarks? Further remarks? Anyone wish to make further remarks before Representative Aller speaks? Representative Ollers.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, apparently Ronald Reagan wasn't good enough for everybody in this room here. But if you read the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and focus on what it says and not everything that the United Nations does, you will find that it is very comparable to the things that we believe in as Americans, and that it is about protecting the rights of all humans, ensuring freedom for all humans, and that is very American. And if you're not going to believe Ronald Reagan, then I think you should believe a much wiser man and member of our body, okay? And let's keep the eye on the ball.
Thank you, Representative Ollers.
It didn't work.
Hearing no further remarks, the question before the House is adoption of Senate Concurrent Resolution Number 6. Those in favor will vote yay, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote. Representative Jameson.
Personal privilege?
Granted.
If I could, I'd like to introduce two family members that I have in the audience today. My wife, Beth, and my niece, Cassie Jameson Jackson. If you guys could say hello to those two, I'd appreciate it.
Welcome.
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Goodwin.
Personal privilege?
Granted.
I'm sure everybody's heard of the Dixie Chicks. Well, up in the gallery, we have the Goodwin Chicks. My wife, Marcia, and my daughter-in-law, Beth.
Welcome. Representative Roden. Granted.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, amazingly enough, after last year, my wife came back again this year. So I wanted to take another stab at this.
She is a hearty soul.
The love of my life and wife of 30, no, I shouldn't even start at that, should I? Long time. I'm very pleased to have my wife join me here today. Welcome to appear. Thanks, Sandy, for coming.
Representative Glanzer.
Personal privilege.
Granted.
Thank you. I would like to introduce my wife, Penny, today. She's sitting up there in the blue up in the gallery. I will not tell you that tomorrow she's going to start her 71st trip around the sun. But I will tell you that this year, on August 2nd, we will celebrate 50 years of happy great marriage that we've had. And I invite my fellow legislators that have or will celebrate their 50th anniversary to stand with me and welcome this godly woman.
Welcome.
Just those who have 50 years.
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker.
I only wanted the ones that celebrate 50 years. I thought I'd be standing by myself.
Yeah. Well, some of us look older or are older than we look. So, Representative Reed.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Personal privilege?
Granted.
Well, first of all, I want to thank the last two speakers for showing me what not to do and what not to say. But I'd like to introduce my wife, Mary. We all know what we have to sacrifice when we're here and what our spouses do at home to take care of everything. So I want to thank my wife for coming here and ask the rest of the body to welcome her.
Welcome.
Mr. Speaker.
Let's finish up this one vote and then we'll move on, try to catch another one.
Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
What? Clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were yeas 36, nays 30, and excused 4.
Senate Concurrent Resolution 6, having received a majority vote of the members-elect, is hereby adopted. Motions and resolutions.
Mr. Speaker, House Concurrent Resolution number 1007 is read the first time. It's House Concurrent Resolution encouraging thoughtful taxation of alcohol products in the state and calling for alcohol to become budget neutral rather than a drain on the resources of the economy of South Dakota. House Concurrent Resolution number 1008 is being read the first time. It's a resolution that tobacco, alcohol, and other drug marketing have no place in the lives of children of the state. And House Concurrent Resolution number 1009, encouraging awareness of alcohol as a direct cause of 7 types of cancer, and encourages the Department of Health to research potential awareness campaigns related to alcohol and cancer. Also, Mr. Speaker, Representative Qualm moved that when we adjourn today, we adjourn to convene at 1:30 p.m. Friday, February 2nd, the 16th day, legislative day.
Motion having been made and seconded, all those in favor say aye. Aye. Those opposed, nay. Motion carries. Consideration of committee reports.
Representative Qualm moved that the reports of the standing committees on state affairs on House Bill 1123 is found on page 240 of the House Journal and House Bill 1083 as found on page 241 of the House Journal. Also Judiciary on House Bill 1157 as found on page 242 of the House Journal and House Bill 1085 as found on page 242 of the House Journal. Also Commerce and Energy on House Bill 1070 as found on page 243 of the House Journal be adopted.
Second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. Motion carries. Moving on to first reading of House bills. For those of you in the gallery who aren't aware of this process, it's a constitutional requirement to read the bills twice, so the first reading is often like this to just cover that base, and then we move on to the actual consideration of the bill at a later time. House Bill 1295 will be assigned to Agriculture and Natural Resources. Speaker directs House Bill 1314 to House Appropriations and to Joint Appropriations, House Bills 1279, 1300, 1306, 1307.
Speaker assigns bills number House Bill 1287, 1301, and 1313 to Commerce and Energy. To Education, House Bills 1297, 1298, and 1303. To Health and Human Services, HCR 1009. To Judiciary, House Bills 1280, 1281, 1283, 1290, 1291, 1292, 1293, 1296, and 1299. To State Affairs, House Bills 1285, 1286, 1282, 1289, 1294, 1302, 1304, 1305, 1308, 1310, 1311, 1312, 1315, and HCR 1007. To Taxation, House Bills 1288 and 1309. To Transportation, House Bill 1284. And to Government Operations and Audit, House Bill 1316.
The Speaker declared that House Bill 1208 was withdrawn at the request of the prime sponsor pursuant to Joint Rule 6B-1.1. Also, the Speaker declared that House Bill 1212 was withdrawn at the request of the prime sponsor pursuant to Joint Rule 6B-1.1.
We'll move on to first reading of Senate bills.
Senate Bill 46, an act to require school districts to adopt a policy limiting the use of restraint and seclusion. Senate Bill 61, an act to revise certain provisions regarding sex offender registration. Senate Bill 80, an act to establish term limits for members of the Board of Regents. And Senate Bill 89, an act to establish term limits for members of the Board of Education Standards.
Speaker signs House Bill 46 to Education, Senate Bill 46 to Education, Senate Bill 61 to Judiciary, Senate Bill 80 to Education, and Senate Bill 89 to Education. Consent calendar items.
House Bill 1137, an act to revise certain provisions regarding the registration of lobbyists. And House Bill 1112, an act to revise certain provisions regarding contested paternity.
Consent calendar items are reported out of committees with no dissenting votes or opposition. They're not subject to debate. However, questions may be asked of the sponsor. Are there any questions? Are there any questions? Seeing none, the question before the House is final passage of bills on the consent calendar. Those in favor will vote yay, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Mr. Speaker.
Eilers votes aye.
Representative Turbeville.
Personal privilege.
Granted.
Well, members of the House, I don't have a wife, but I have friends, and they're sitting up in the corner of to your left of the speaker, the leadership, South Dakota alumni from the past three classes. Welcome.
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Zickmund.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to introduce my wife. She's sitting up, she's hiding from me, I think, up somewhere along there. I think if she could stand up. Is she standing up? She's standing up. Anyway, she's my just everything, and she and I will be married, Representative Ganser, this year, 50 years, and we did our little trip when we got married to the Black Hills. So, however, we're going to change that this year, and we're planning on going to Hawaii in October. So, she's been with me quite a while, and I couldn't live without her. She's just been everything to me, and she's a good walker. So, you want to remember that. But anyway, can I get another small privilege?
Let's thank her for being here.
I'd like to just state, and I wasn't going to say anything, but I had the opportunity, distinct honor and opportunity to work with the great George Mickelson. And there isn't a person that I would really honor as much as I would him, because I had, he was just such a great guy to work for. His family is a just a super family. We had the opportunity to spend some time over at the mansion because my daughter went to the prom with representative's brother, David. And so it was just a great time, a great time to know them. So it's so, so deserving of this bus. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Representatives Goodwin, Marty, York, and Stevens. Representative Stevens.
Representative Stevens.
Stevens votes aye. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
The clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there are yeas 67, excused 3.
Consent bills having received a majority vote of the members are hereby declared passed. Are there any questions on the titles? Hearing none, the titles are deemed correct. Second reading of House bills.
Mr. Speaker, Representative Quam moved that House Bill 1258 be referred from the Committee on Commerce and Energy to the Committee on Transportation.
Seconded. Having been seconded, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries.
House Bill 1024, an act to revise certain provisions regarding South Dakota One Call.
House Bill 1024, having had its second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Are there any remarks?
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House Bill 1024 came before the Commerce Committee. It's a agency bill regarding the South Dakota One Call. Again, there were no opponents in the testimony, and there are some amendments, I understand, but there was no opposition to this. This is simple. Some people have described it as a divorce of the South Dakota One Call from the Public Utilities Commission, but since there is no litigation involved, I can't see how that can be described as a divorce. But what we have here is it requires an annual report from the South Dakota One Call. It allows the One Call Board to collect unpaid penalties, and it clarifies the current statute that the One Call Board is indeed its own state agency, only attached to the PUC for reporting their budget. There are no general funds involved. I would encourage a green vote on this simple House Bill 1024.
Any further remarks? Representative Willardson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would like to move Amendment 1024 WA, and it has been distributed.
Is there a second? Second. Are there any remarks on the motion? Representative Willardson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The amendment that you have on your desk, it just says that the provisions of this act shall take effect on July 1st, 2019. The One Call Board and the PUC got together and decided that a little bit of extra time, you know, to make the transition to the One Call Board being on their own would be in order. And so, again, all the parties are in agreement with the amendment, and I'd appreciate its passage.
Thank you, Representative. Any further remarks? If you'd take a look at that amendment and just tell me if that's exactly what you want it to say. Representative, is that stated correctly that it'd be on line 4 of page 2?
Mr. Speaker?
Yes.
the PUC provided us with this amendment, and I didn't look it up. I trusted them to do it correctly since it was their amendment.
Representative Rounds.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Substitute motion.
The motion?
On House Bill 1024, on page 2, after line 19, section 2, the provisions of this act shall take effect July 1, 2019.
Right. The motion having been made to do an amendment to the amendment.
And Mr. Speaker, if I may.
Yes, Representative Rounds.
The amendment as drawn that's been sent out was on the the printed version of the bill. We had an amendment in Commerce Committee, at which time the bill was expanded a little bit, so we're dealing with the engrossed version now, and so this amendment should be on line 20, it should be a line 20 or after line 19 is where this should fit in.
So the substitute motion is to amend with the same words, but to place that following the end of line 19 on page 2, is that correct?
Mr. Speaker, that is correct.
All right. That motion having been made and seconded, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries. Now, back to the bill. Are there any further remarks in regard to HB 1024 as amended?
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Zickman.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This did come up in Commerce, and two of us, a good representative from Brookings and myself, had a little problem with it. You have to understand, all those of you that are in construction, et cetera, that one call is very, very important to everybody in the construction industry plus. We had a little problem with it. Number one, we knew it wasn't presented right, correctly, and we thought that there needed to be some work done on it. Plus, we had some of the electrical companies that contacted us after that had some problems with it. So. I think those problems have been taken care of. I've talked to some of those electrical companies. They're comfortable with what the changes that have been made, and I think they would be okay with amended as changed. So, Mr. Speaker, I would recommend that we adopt this. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much for the remarks. Representative Roden.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Question for the sponsor.
State your question.
Well, I understand the process we go through, and we make decisions based on what's in front of us. In the case of this bill, now we've amended it to not go into effect for something like 18 months, July 1st of 2019. My question is, at this point, why not wait until next year to allow another year to go by to see what, you know, if anything changed between now and then. Obviously, you'd have more than enough time to do it a year from now. Why not wait instead of making the decisions now for 18 months down the road?
Representative, would you like to answer that question?
Yes, I'll answer that. The discussion in committee was simple, and that is that there is real no significant change in the law. It is today as it has been for a substantial period of time. They're just clarifying the code. The only difference was that there's a difference now in that the PUC, or the South Dakota One Call Board, can now collect their own penalties without having the PUC do so. So there's no significant changes in the law. There were two minor revisions to statute, and then just that one statute that clarified that South Dakota One Call can now collect their own penalties. So I don't know. I'm hoping that'll answer your question, but we're just trying to clarify the law so that it's similar to and standing in the same vein as the Animal Industry Board is. It's a good parallel.
Representative Johnson, I think there is a representative over here who would like to assist in answering that question too. Representative Willitson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The only significant change that this bill makes is it requires the One Call Board to submit an annual report. That annual report goes to the Appropriations Committee. So if we don't pass this now, they still won't have that requirement that they submit that report. If we wait till next year to do it, are we doing any damage? I can't answer that. But that is the one thing of substance that this bill does, that you know, we would like to see that report go to the committee. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you very much for the questions, comments. Representative Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We were very concerned about this issue because we didn't want to see some group emancipate itself away from being oversought by somebody else, but that wasn't the case because the PUC pointed out to us that this one call's always been pretty much on its own, even though it was assigned to the PUC. The PUC was pushing to get, so as to speak, the training wheels off this one call board and cease from using the PUC staff, because the PUC is getting busier and busier with all the issues coming up. So therefore, they decided that it was time just for the One Call Board to take over on its own. They're not going to employ any new FTEs or any such thing, was my understanding. So I don't think there's anything sinister about this bill at all. I think it's a good bill, and it just needs to be moved along. Thank you.
Right, thank you, Representative. Representative Roden, did I cut you off, or did you have your question answered?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. No, I did not get my question answered, but I don't think I'm going to get an answer, so thank you very much.
All right, thank you. Representative Rounds.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'll give it my best. We had this bill in committee, and during discussions in committee, we didn't know if there was enough time by July 1st to implement what the One Call Board wanted to do. This was discussed around, you know, it was July 1st, and the PUC said, well, we'll continue to work with them. But here again, they're the reason why we're passing this bill, or we're moving this bill through, is to get them separated, to allow an agency to act on its own, except for through the budgetary process. So during the course, and that's why this bill's been a week now sitting there, I guess the discussion was on how to come to an agreement or a compromise on the bill, and they compromised on 18 months. You know, I had first suggested, well, maybe we should wait till January 1st of next year. It was decided, let's give it another 6 months to let them, as the previous speaker, so I thought the previous speaker answered the question in her testimony, get the training wheels off, give them a chance to adjust. There's no additional dollars being spent. It's going to be pass-through dollars, their own funds. A lot of contractual work will remain the same.
but they just needed to cut the umbilical cord. And the discussion was, do we do it July 1st? Do we do it January 1st of next year? They decided to give it 18 months for the clean break. And we come back next year, if something's happening that's not right, we can fix it before the time comes. But I think it's a good bill. We should move forward with it.
Representative Mickelson.
The one thing that's really clear in the way this bill's written is that the Public Utilities Commission does not want to be responsible for the functions of the one-call board, okay? I don't know if that's a good idea or a bad idea, but before I vote for this bill to say they're not, someone better stand up and tell me who is, because someone is. And so that's what I'd like to know before I take the responsibility, vote to take the responsibility away from the place it's been. Who is in charge? That's all I want to know. So whoever's closing this deal out, if you can answer that question, you can get my vote, maybe.
Representative Wilson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, I'll attempt to answer that question. The PUC has never been responsible for the one-call board. The one-call board has always held their own responsibility. They've got their own board members that are appointed by the governor. The one-call board was started in the early 1990s by the governor for the purpose of protection of the people. As a matter of economy, he associated the one-call board with the PUC. It kind of makes sense because, you know, the PUC regulates utilities and such. The one-call board, their responsibility is for marking power lines, gas lines, other utility lines for that part of it. So as a matter of economy, the one-call board was associated with the PUC only for the purposes of assisting them when they did their budget report and for some legal staff, that when they had a legal issue, that the legal staff and the PUC would help them with that legal issue. The PUC has never had control over the one-call board. The one-call board could tell the PUC to go jump in the lake, and there isn't anything that the PUC could do about it. They've never had control over them. They've only been associated with the PUC for the matter of economy. Now the PUC, or the, excuse me, the one-call board has grown on its own, and it's become working and operating. It's had several years of experience on that part. And so the PUC and the one-call board got together and they agreed, okay, we should try to start separating our association. The PUC will still assist the one-call board with the matters of the budgetary process. That's done in a number of other boards. They're associated with an agency, you know, for those same purposes. We got the language from the Animal Industry Board. Well, they're associated with the Department of Agriculture for the same reasons. But the Department of Agriculture doesn't have any control over the Animal Industry Board either. This is the same deal. They're two separate entities. The one call board, they handle their own operations and do that. They're simply associated with the PUC for efficiency, and now it's time that we take one of the training wheels off and see if they can pedal that bike. So I hope that answers your question. I hope you're willing to give it a green light, and let's send this on to the Senate. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
All right, thank you very much. And I think that we need to address a clarification in regard to the motion to amend, just so the lines in the sections are correct. Representative Rounds? I believe the appropriate motion to amend would be...
Yeah. Can I withdraw, Mr. Speaker? May I withdraw the previous motion?
Yes, you may.
Thank you. And then I would like to make an amendment.
Proceed.
She took my amendment.
I believe the motion that you're going to be making would be Section 4, which would become Line 20.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to move that on page 2, after line 19 of the House Commerce and Energy Committee engrossed bill, insert Section 4, period. The provisions of this act shall take effect on July 1, 2019.
Thank you. Seconded by Willardson. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries. Now, any further remarks in regard to the bill as amended? Hearing nothing further. Representative Rounds.
Mr. Speaker, if I may, we've been tossed a gauntlet by the good representative from Minnehaha County to sell him on why this is a good idea. I can't remember word for word what his question was, but let's start back in 1993 when a body of people elected by the people decided to create the One Call Board. And they put it under the administration of the PUC, but they declared them an agency on their own, but they were still administered by the PUC. And their budgeting was through the PUC, although they had a separate budget. Over the years, there's been a few amendments and changes, but now it is time for the PUC not to have this taking up time. They're too busy. If you look at their calendar, if you look at their duties, they are busy. The One Call Board is an elected board, and they have an executive director, and they have the ability to run their agency. They have contractors that they work with for the services provided. I don't see where the question is on this. I think they can go along as an agency. They've been doing it for 20-some years as an agency. Let's take the training wheels off. Let's give it a little bit of time. You know, they wanted another year or so to get the rust out. Then let's let them be on their own. All their dollars come from other funds. They're pass-through dollars for the use, and then the One Call sends them out to contractors. I don't know what else the good representative from Lincoln and Minnehaha but hopefully I've answered some of it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Representative Mickelson.
Ice cream uncle. Okay, I'll vote for this bill.
Just as a point of clarification, we want to make sure that the motions to amend were fully requested to be withdrawn and that we ended up with the final motion to amend as the final amendment. So for clarification, you're moving to withdraw your substitute motion, and that withdraws the amendment.
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Rounds.
If I withdraw the substitute motion, then that would require a withdrawal of the original motion. Then the correct amendment motion that I made. Does that make sense?
That's close enough. So let's vote on the motion to amend. All those in favor say aye. With this withdrawal of the motion to amend, and those opposed, nay. Hearing none, motion to withdraw is approved and passed. And the original amendment, Representative Willardson.
Mr. Speaker, I wish to withdraw the original amendment that I listed, WA.
Is there a second? Second it. And any discussion on the motion? Hearing none. All those in favor say aye. Those opposed, nay. Motion carries. So now we are finally at the point of hearing. I don't care to hear any more emotions. And hearing no further remarks, question before the House is final passage of House Bill 1024 as amended. Those in favor will vote yea, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and members will proceed to vote. Representative Gosch.
Personal privilege, please.
Granted.
I would like your honorable body here to please help me in welcoming an individual with a giant heart, both beautiful inside and outside, and a big, important part of my life. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Don Greenfield. Oh, my wife is here too.
She took that fairly well. Representative Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Yes, I'd like to welcome my husband, Don, here today. He is my love of my life, going on 48 years later on this year. He is manning the store while I'm gone. I'm lying. Anyway, I was just going to mention as a matter of trivia that he and Representative Tolson have been lifelong friends. They were both inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame, South Dakota Baseball Hall of Fame, in the same year. So I would ask that you would welcome him.
Thank you very much.
I didn't know I had to compete with Representative Gosch.
Everybody take a look at your voting, whether you've completed your voting. Representative Dennard.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I wasn't able to do this last year, but for the first time, I would like to introduce my beautiful bride, Ashton, to the House.
Welcome.
Representative DeSanto and Otten Herman.
Representative Rounds.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I just noticed a reoccurring theme, except for the good representative from Clark. Everybody all seem to have married up. Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there are yeas 58, nays 9, and 3 excused.
House Bill 1024, as amended, having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed correct.
House Bill 1148, an act to revise certain provisions regarding the eligibility to serve on the Game, Fish, and Parks Commission.
House Bill 1148, having had its second readings up for consideration, final passage, are there any remarks? Representative Peterson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, members of the House. House Bill 1148 is a common sense update to the eligibility requirements for the Game, Fish, and Parks Commission. The commission is currently made up of 8 members, at least 4 of which shall be farmers. Current statute states the farmer must reside on the farm, be engaged in agriculture, deriving at least 2/3 of their gross annual incomes from crop or livestock production or both. The update I am asking you to consider today is to add the words, or working primarily on a farm. Here's what that means. If someone farms but lives in town or on an acreage off of their land, they currently do not qualify to serve on the commission. The change I am asking you to make would be to make them eligible as well, as long as they meet the other current requirements of being engaged in agriculture, deriving at least 2/3 of their gross annual incomes from crop or livestock production or both. I don't think a farmer is any less of a farmer or not qualified to serve on this commission because of where they sleep at night. This bill is being brought to increase the pool of potential people that can be considered for this commission, and I think it's a reasonable change. I would appreciate your favorable consideration. I'd be happy to stand by for any questions.
Thank you, Representative. Further remarks? further remarks? Hearing no further remarks, the question before the House is final passage of House Bill 1148. Those in favor will vote yea. Those opposed, nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine. The members will proceed to vote. Representative Chase.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Now it's my turn. I get to introduce my lovely wife, Michelle, and thank her for letting me do what I do.
Thank you. It's a great day when so many spouses get to show up and spend some time together and spend time in peers. So that's a good thing.
Bless my soul with thy.
Representative Chase. I'm sorry, Lake.
Thank you. I'm not going to try and be clever because I need a date tonight and I don't want to screw it up. I already spent $30. So I would like to recognize my wife, Bridget Lake, sitting up onto the left.
Mrs. Lake.
Representative Ollers, Beal, Johnson, Lake, May, Steinhauer.
Representative Beal.
Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were yeas 58, nays 9, and 3 excused.
House Bill 1148, having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Are there any corrections to the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed correct.
House Bill 1110, 1110, an act to increase the penalty for certain subsequent convictions of hiring for sexual activity or promoting prostitution.
House Bill 1110, having had its second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Are there any remarks? Representative Holmes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House Bill 1110 is an act to increase the penalty for certain subsequent convictions of hiring for sexual activity or promoting prostitution. The bill right now will change our current law. At the present time, if someone hires a prostitute, they are charged with a misdemeanor. This bill would up the second offense to a Class 6 felony. It has been supported by the Attorney General's office as well as the state's attorney. It came out of judiciary with a unanimous vote. The primary focus is to provide support to victims once they have been identified. Those served typically have no family and no resources, which makes it difficult for them to leave sex trafficking. The women and youth served often feel like they have no other option but to stay and be taken care of by their trafficker. They have no home. If they do have a home, likely they can't go back for safety reasons. They have no money, food, and little to no clothing. Many need years of specialized services, such as professional counseling, sometimes up to 3 sessions a week, depending on how intense the recovery is. 95% of the women served last year needed drug addiction and mental health counseling. Because of their intense trauma, most can't hold full-time jobs, as it is too overwhelming for them emotionally and physically. Over the course of the last 2 years, 104 individuals have been served. It's a tough journey for those who are the victims. Once they are identified and begin the healing process, many face unforeseen barriers. The resources to get a survivor back on track are exhausting. The best thing our state can do to stop the cycle of human trafficking is to hold those who are purchasing victims accountable. If we did not have purchasers, there would be no need to recruit or pull victims into human trafficking. Victims are sold by gangs, mafia, and even family members. The reason that these people sell women, children, and boys is because they make big money doing it. It's organized crime. It's business, and that's how they make a living. The money made from human trafficking is approaching that money made from illegal drugs. If we take away the ability for these people to make money, then we can curb the selling of human beings. The only way to do that is to stop individuals from hiring another person for a fee to engage in sexual activity. This is why House Bill 1110 is so important. When we pass this bill, we stand strong to combat human trafficking in the state of South Dakota. We need to have strong legislation so we are not vulnerable. I urge you on behalf of the victims, use your vote to stop the cycle of sex trafficking by holding those on the demand side accountable. Please vote green. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative. I should point out, too, that there was a prison jail population cost estimate statement that is available associated with the bill on the internet. Essentially, it shows that there would be a potential net increase in costs if these people were imprisoned as opposed to being jailed, a net increase of approximately $3,000, $3,000 to $4,000. Further remarks? Further remarks? In regard to House Bill 1110, hearing no further remarks, question before the House is final passage of House Bill 1110. Those in favor will vote yea, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Turbeville, aye. Duvall, aye. Latterell, aye.
Mr. Speaker.
Allers, aye.
Representative Johnson.
Personal privilege.
Granted.
Well, there is another one. My number, unlike the representative from Brown County, that's only 48 years, and the representative from Beadle County is 50 years. Well, for me, it's 11,703 days that I've been married to my wife. I don't know how she puts up with it. But if my wife, Karen, would stand up. And Karen. Yeah, that's right, 11,703. And I would ask Karen if you'll give me another 11,000. And one more thing, I do love you.
Representative Holmes.
Just because you wouldn't say it first, huh?
Representative Carr. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were yeas 67, excused 3.
House Bill 1110, having received majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed correct.
House Bill 1121, an act to revise the fees for certain on-sale and off-sale retail liquor licenses.
House Bill 1121, having had its second readings up for consideration and final passage, are there any remarks? Representative Johns.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, members of the House. This bill is being brought on behalf of the Department of Revenue. It's an act to revise the fees for certain on-sale and off-sale retail liquor licenses. There's currently different fee structures for on-sale liquor licenses, which would permit the sale and service of any alcoholic beverage for consumption on licensed premises, and for off-sale liquor licenses, which permits the sale of any alcoholic beverages for consumption off the licensed premises. Depending on the class of the municipality, issuing the license. When I asked the department why historically there was any distinction, nobody could ever give me an answer. There is no answer. This has caused confusion amongst the municipalities, and I believe it's just arbitrary. It's suppressed the market value of licenses in many of our smaller communities. This bill makes the fee structure on sale and off sale retail liquor licenses the same for all classes. The impacted license are off sale retail liquor license. Current law, not less than 500 in a class one municipality with a renewal fee of not more than 500. So initially you get 500 for the issuance, but then every year thereafter it's a renewal fee to be set up to 500. For a class two municipality, it's 400 both for the initial and the renewal fee. This is annual income then for every municipality. And then for a class three municipality, it's $300 whether it's initial or a renewal fee. The proposed change is to set it at 300 for all classes of municipalities, that's the initial, not less than 300, with a renewal fee of not more than 500. On sale retail liquor licenses within a municipality and for your convention facility on sale licenses. Current law provides for not less than $1 per person residing in the municipality per the last census. For a class one municipality, it's a $1,500 renewal fee. For a class two, it's $1,200 for an initial and for a renewal. And for a class three, it's a flat $900 whether it's initial or a renewal. The proposed change is not less than $1 per person residing in the municipality per the last census for all classes of municipalities with a renewal fee of not more than $1,500. And then we have on sale retail liquor licenses which are outside of municipalities. Current law provides for not less than the maximum amount charged by the nearest municipality. So the renewal fee would be the same as the nearest municipality. If the nearest municipality under our current law is more than 15 miles away, then the county commission will set the fee not to exceed $1,500. The proposed change is not less than the amount charged by the nearest municipality, and the renewal fee then would be the same for as charged in the nearest municipality. Those are the changes. I would ask that you give this your due consideration.
Thank you, Representative Johns. Further remarks? Representative Gosch.
I have an amendment.
Has it been distributed?
It has.
Do you wish to move it at this time?
I do, please.
Is there a second?
Second!
Point of order, Representative Latterell.
Mr. Speaker, could you name the amendment?
It is Amendment 1121AA, as in Alcoholics Anonymous.
Clever.
I'm that way sometimes.
You may proceed.
Okay, I would like to amend this bill. I think it's a good bill, and I like what he's trying to do. Essentially, he's trying to unify the code right now. The only issue are the numbers they used when they went with the renewals for the licenses. So, as he stated, there's multiple tiers in the licensing renewal. There's one, two, and three. So they unified it, but the problem is they used the highest number. So in certain situations, in our smaller towns and our smaller off-sale liquor stores, their renewal is going to go from $900 to $1,500. That's a substantial increase. So my amendment simply would more benefit those that were at $1,500 and let them come down to $900. So on page 2, line 3, it would strike 500 down to 300. Page 2, line 9, strikes 15 and inserts 9. And then on page 3, line 16, overstrike 15 and insert 9.
Thank you. Further remarks, Representative Johns.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As an attorney for a Class 2 municipality, upon consideration, I have to speak against this proposed amendment. It's going to cost my city money on every renewal fee. For a Class 1, it's even going to cost them even more. Currently, we would receive a renewal fee in a Class II municipality for off-sale liquor license, a fee of $400. This is going to take us down to $300. You have to read it. It says a renewal fee of not more than $500. Your municipality can charge whatever they want with a floor of not less than three. So what he's going to do with the proposed off-sale liquor retail liquor license is to say it's going to be a flat fee of $300, whereas currently, under the proposed change, your city commission board can set it at whatever rate they want to between that $300 and the $500, so they have some discretion. This is going to take away the discretion. They don't have to charge $500. They can charge $300 if you're a Class III municipality. The change for on-sale retail liquor license then for a Class I would be $1,500. He's taken it to $900. It says it's not more than $900. But with the proposal, it's not more than. Remember, the language is not more. They still have the discretion to charge what they want with a floor on each one of these. And the same thing applies to on-sale retail liquor licenses for your convention facility. Currently, it's $1,500 for a Class I. It would be $1,200 for a Class II. He's going to take, the proposal is, and I shouldn't say he, the good representative from East River Walworth. Yeah, Mobridge. The proposal is that it's going to cost, if you're from a Class I or a Class II city, this proposal is going to cost them money. So think where you live. That's all I'm bringing to your attention. If you're from some other municipality, maybe it matters not, or if you live in the country, but from my perspective, representing the city of Lead, I can't go home and say you're going to lose money over this proposition. So think about where you're from. Thank you.
Further remarks, Representative Jameson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Just a quick comment on the proposed amendment. I would urge you to resist this amendment as well. Goodwill intended. The impact for the city, the great city of Sioux Falls, would be roughly $63,000 a year. And the revenue that's created from these renewals are returned to the city to operate and to maintain everything that a city does. And one of the things that we do is go around and do compliance checks with all these license holders to ensure that they're not selling to underage individuals. Losing this money would actually cause in Sioux Falls probably wouldn't cause a big challenge, but maybe in other communities it would. But in essence, what we're doing is we're associating a fee with a service that we're providing and related it to those alcohol industries. So I urge you to resist this amendment and vote no.
Thank you, Representative. Further remarks? Representative Gosh.
Mr. Speaker, latitude to speak on the amendment and the bill.
Go ahead.
So what I'm understanding is we need to make this uniform, but we're going to go ahead and make the little guy pay $1,500. Now, I know it says up to, but next time when you guys get home this weekend, I want you guys to get two $10 bills, hand them to your kid and say, here's $20, but you can take 10 if you want. I mean, that's what's going to happen. So essentially, we're trying to unify the code, but we're still trying to increase the fee to the maximum. The arguments that I heard from the previous two speakers, then let's just vote down this bill because we're going to penalize otherwise. We're trying to unify the code, but we're trying to jack the rates up on the little guy. So essentially, what I'm saying is if you want to unify the code, but don't penalize people for unifying the code. Rather, give other entities, other businesses a break. Don't penalize the other guys at their expense. So I would urge you guys to vote for this amendment. If we're going to unify it, let's unify it. Let's come up with one number. Let's let it be the smaller number. Let's give that back to these businesses and these businesses in Sioux Falls and other areas. And let's make it right for the people. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative. Hearing no further remarks, the question being Representative Gosh's motion to amend House Bill 1121. Does any member wish to the motion to amend be reread? If not, those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay.
No.
Motion does not carry. So back to the main bill, House Bill 1121. Any further remarks? Representative Pischke.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, I appreciate the great debate we've had so far. I do wish to speak to the bill and the reason that I was a no vote in committee. And speaking to specifically where I live, the reason I voted no is if you look at this bill and where we are, I'm in a class two municipality. And right now, to get for a new on-sale license, we have a restriction of it's going to be $1,200, no more than. And if this bill passes, that would change to not less than $1 per capita. That would mean that if a new bar or establishment to come up in Del Rapids would now be charged around $3,800. And I feel that that's another barrier to the market, especially in a market like Del Rapids where we only have a limited number of restaurants in town, and I would like to see more restaurants come to town. So I want to keep that liquor license as low as possible to encourage businesses to come to town. So I want everyone to keep that in mind. Again, keep in mind where you live, and that's the reason for my no vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Pischke. Further remarks? Seeing none other than Representative Johns, would you like to finish us up?
Thank you. I would like to remind everybody that in most municipalities there are no available liquor licenses. So if you want a liquor license, you have to buy it from someone who already holds a license. This only applies for the new licenses if they have an extra license. And then, you know, in that case, if my municipality is limited to $1,200, I might as well go buy it myself because I'm going to be able to turn it around and sell it for a lot more than $1,200 because it's whatever the market bears. If you want to keep it where it is, then that's your decision. But I think it's good legislation. I ask you to vote yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative. Hearing no further remarks, the question before the House, final passage of House Bill 1121. Those in favor will vote yay, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and members will proceed to vote. Representative Jensen.
Personal privilege?
Granted.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I know everybody, I'll probably maybe be the last one to do the introductions, but I want to introduce my business partner, my best friend, and my wife of about almost 28 years old, you know, and who has given me three sons, three wonderful daughters-in-law, six grandchildren, and without her, none of that would have happened, and I don't even know if I'd be here today. Without all of her support, I would like to introduce my wife, Darcy Jensen.
Welcome. We're glad to see you're recuperating. And I think I first got acquainted with Darcy a long time ago at the detox center.
Representative Barthel.
And I appreciate all that she did.
Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there was yeas 46, nays 21, excused 3.
House Bill 1121, having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Are there any questions on the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed correct. And I should clarify that having met her there, I processed hundreds of involuntary commitments, and she was devoted to the task that she had there to evaluate those and provide services there at the detox center. And thousands of people have gone through there. So thank you.
House Bill 1125, an act to revise the minimum purchase price for the off-sale delivery of certain alcohol.
House Bill 1125, having had its second reading, is up for consideration, final passage. Are there any remarks? Representative Steinhauer.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is really a pretty simple bill. Last year, we passed a law that would enable the home delivery of alcohol. Now, to get that home delivery, you first have to go into a store with an off-sale liquor license. You have to prove that you're 21, and you have to assure that the liquor is delivered and received by someone that's 21, and they have to prove at the time of delivery that the person receiving is 21. We also required last year that the person purchasing the alcohol and delivering the alcohol, it has to be $150 in value. First minor tweak is we said it had to be an alcoholic beverage. I'm not sure who'd buy $150 worth of, well, whatever, a kind of alcohol, but it's now alcoholic beverages, right? But this caught some people that had an off-sale liquor license that was brought to my attention, and they have a business and they like to do gift baskets and things, and they do have a proper liquor license, and someone will come in and say, I want to have a gift box or a gift basket delivered to some of my employees. Would you stick a bottle of wine in there? The answer is no, you can't, unless it's a $150 bottle of wine. And as I said to some people, that'd be a huge waste on me. Mine usually comes in a box, but $150 to add to that is a little steep. So what this law does, it says you still have to have that threshold of $150, but now it can be a combination of non-alcoholic items and alcoholic items. Still got to be 21, still got to be in the store, got to be delivered to someone 21, but it can now be a combination of alcohol and non-alcoholic items. So I'll stand by for questions.
Thank you, Representative Steinhauer. Further remarks? Representative Hawley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I need to oppose the bill. You were all here last year, so this references that. We had this bill come through Commerce last year on the floor. The reason that we passed this bill last year, it was presented to us that there's a need if you have a large social event and you're going to buy a lot of alcohol, that you could go to the store, buy it, and then they would deliver it to somebody when you're 21. And that was the reason that we passed this bill. Now, the next year, we slipped another stage down, and it isn't a social event. The comment was, well, I don't know who would buy $150. Well, that was the argument last year for the bill. And now we're saying, well, nobody's going to buy $150. You're going to buy a bottle of wine with a basket, so give them that. So I just have problems with the expansion of the bill so quickly. Maybe if I was brand new here 5 years from now, I'd have no problem. But when seeing the process that works and the arguments that we've used in the past, I can't support the bill like this. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative. Further remarks? Representative Hunoff.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members of the House, I will preempt. I don't have an off-sale license. The bill before we debated, and the issue that was brought in hand, is that we were looking at the small person, the small business. What this intent is now to take that business away from a small person. Yes, I'm from Yankton, and there are other large establishments that sell other products beside liquor, but they're also small liquor stores. If you go to your community, smaller rural places, they just have the liquor store and they don't have the gift packages. Now, it would be very easy for me to walk into one of the larger retail centers in Yankton, and I could spend $140 on groceries, and then I could just have to spend the $10 or $20 that I needed for the alcoholic beverages and have it delivered to my home. If I'm a small retailer, I can't compete with that because I probably don't have a lot of those items in my store. I mean, I have my alcohol and you've got those bad tobacco products and you've got candies and things, but as far as being an incentive to come in there. So as a small retailer, how am I going to compete with somebody who we all buy groceries and we all buy or wherever those larger places that have those off-sale products on? So I would just think for you to consider. The last bill, there was a lot of, you know, concern, and what do we do? This is another example that we're expanding out, and it's really the small business person that's going to be impacted. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you for the remarks. Representative Otten.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker and fellow members. Well, a little clarity. This was my bill last year. I sponsored this thing. And you know, we did have the conversation around the alcohol and the $150, and the whole thought process last year with it is that if I was catering a birthday party to my house, that I could also have them deliver the alcohol with it at that time, and that's why we put in the minimum of $150 for the alcohol, so we didn't get somebody calling at 10 o'clock to have something delivered at 1 o'clock at their house. I think they can maybe do this now by circumventing that dollar amount to where they maybe could have alcohol sent to their place at 2 o'clock at night with a phone call, or if they prepaid it, you know, before, because you have to pay in person with it. So I understand where the good representative's coming with this, and I don't think it's a bad idea, but I think it kind of guts what we did last year with this bill. So I'm going to have to oppose it for that reason. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative. Further remarks? Further remarks? Representative Steinhauer.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. First of all, as we all know, you don't get married to bills, and I'm not married to these bills, so do what you think's right. But, you know, the small versus big, as I said in committee, being 5'8 and a quarter, I've always been a, you know, somebody for the small guy, right? So this is really, I wasn't approached by a big box retailer. I understand that it might impact them. Let's think about that, though. If you're going to go buy groceries and you want to get alcohol, why don't you just push them out in the cart to your car and take your bottle of wine and your groceries home with you? Why would you go there and buy, as somebody asked in a committee, why don't I get, you know, what happens with a guy that gets $130 worth of lettuce and some beer delivered and he sets it up so it comes every day? Well, I'd call that a regular customer, and pun intended, if he's getting that much lettuce and beer, right? I think that this is really just a deal that's allowing free enterprise. If you don't have the ability to track that customer into your place of business, and you gotta go in to make the purchase, you gotta go to the store to make the purchase, and if it's for yourself, you're gonna take it home. Unless it's a party, as we talked about before, but if it's for yourself, you're gonna take it home. Otherwise, what you're doing is a gift basket where you've maybe got a handful of employees that you want to have sent to them, and you'd like to have wine in it. That's what we're talking about. It's not necessarily big versus small, and I like the small guy as much as everybody else. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Hearing no further remarks, the question before the House is final passage of House Bill 1125. Those in favor will vote yea. Those opposed, nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine, and the members will proceed to vote.
Gosh votes aye. Dinner votes aye. Representative Goodwin. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were yeas 26, nays 41, and excused 3.
House Bill 1125, not having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared lost. Moving on to the second reading of Senate bills.
Senate Bill 22, an act to allow commercial driver license applicants 3 attempts to pass the commercial driver license examination.
Senate Bill 22, having had its second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Are there any remarks? Are there any remarks in regard to Senate Bill 22?
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Goodwin.
I stand in support of this bill. It's a good bill that takes commercial driver license and regular driver's license, puts them together where you get three attempts, only have to pay once, so you can flunk it three times, pay one fee. Regular driver's license is $28, commercial's $33. It's a good bill, and I urge you to support it.
Thank you, Representative. Further remarks? Representative Latterell.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate the prime sponsor for bringing this bill. I've considered getting my CDL, and I believe this bill would save me $66.
Or more. Further remarks? Further remarks? Hearing no further remarks, question before the House, final passage of Senate Bill 22. Those in favor will vote yay, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine. The members will proceed to vote.
Dinner votes aye. Representatives Howard and Rasmussen. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were yeas 58, nays 9, and excused 3.
Senate Bill 22, having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed correct.
Senate Bill 66, an act to require each school board to provide certain information regarding school elections in the school board minutes.
Senate Bill 66, having had its second readings up for consideration and final passage, are there any remarks? Representative Bruner.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, it's a very simple bill. I'll try to give it a simple explanation. It has to do with school districts right after the election. The first meeting, they canvassed the votes. This just asks them to enter four things in the minutes, which is the number of registered voters of the district and the number of registered voters who voted, and the percentage of voters, and if the election was held in conjunction with the regular municipal or a regular June primary. Very simple, very minimal time taken, and just put some more information out there. In the spirit of transparency, I think it's good information, might actually stimulate some people to vote. So thank you.
Thank you very much for the remarks. Representative Willardson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. A question for the sponsor.
State your question.
After you get this information and make it part of the public record, what do you intend that be done with it?
Representative Bruner, you wish to answer the question?
Well, you can do with it whatever you want to do with it. It's information that's made available to the public. So these are numbers that might mean something to somebody and might spur somebody to get off their behind and vote next time.
Representative Willardson, does that answer your question?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Further remarks? Hearing no further remarks, question before the House is final passage of Senate Bill 66. Those in favor will vote yay, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine. The members will proceed to vote. Representative Duvall. Granted.
Pishke votes aye.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I would like to introduce, not my spouse who was here earlier but snuck away, but my oldest daughter, Lane Manson. She is a former page. She's also a constituent of the good representatives from Brookings. She's here today for the Research Park reception, which will be held later at the Red Rosa. So please help me welcome my daughter, Lane Manson.
Welcome.
Representatives Ahlers, Carr, and Mickelson. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were yeas 58, nays 9, and excused 3.
Senate Bill 66, having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Are there any questions on the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed correct.
Senate Bill 67, an act to permit a victim of child sex trafficking or exploitation to expunge any criminal or delinquency record obtained as a result of the victimization.
Senate Bill 67, having had its second readings up for consideration and final passage, are there any remarks? Representative Holmes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. If a minor is taken into trafficking, oftentimes she is shot up with narcotics to make her dependent, to make her a drug addict. She then can be coerced into committing crimes, minor crimes, but enough to give her a record. And if she is fortunate enough to escape her trafficker, she will find, if she attempts to reestablish her life in a decent way, that her criminal record prohibits her. What this bill would do would be to allow a minor who has been trafficked to go before a judge and ask to have her record expunged. The judge then would have up to a year to determine if he should do just that. This bill is supported by the Attorney General's office, state's attorneys, and it came out of Judiciary Committee with a unanimous vote. When victims are trafficked, there is a chance that they committed various crimes while under their trafficker's control. These charges have included prostitution, drugs, and theft. Once a victim is identified and begins the healing process, their criminal record becomes a huge barrier to obtaining work, housing, care, and academic opportunities. It may also prevent them from obtaining a professional license, joining the military, obtaining or retaining a driver's license, or accessing benefits from crime victims' compensation. Despite much healing and restoration that may take place, facing barriers from criminal records result in further victimization. The struggle to obtain a normal life for a survivor at times seems impossible. They so desperately want to move forward with a new identity, but it's extremely difficult to do so when they are constantly reminded of their past. They did not choose this life. They were thrust into it by force, fraud, or coercion. This is why Senate Bill 67 is so important. It gives these youths an opportunity for a new identity. I would like to read to you now some of the comments made by a victim who's now attempting to reestablish her life in a community. She says, "Today, I'm 10 months clean of drugs and alcohol. I've been a client of Call to Freedom for about 2 years. I work full-time, and for the most part, I am able to provide for myself, but once again, it's hard for me to live somewhere safe and comfortable because I have a felony and can't pass the background checks on housing applications. I work construction with some inappropriate men because construction is a field that accepts my record and pays well. I've been proudly serving my community as a volunteer firefighter for 7 months now because this is something that gives me a sense of purpose and allows my past to be used beneficially, not just to me, but to others as well. I didn't always respect law enforcement, and the fire department had to be called many times to save me from overdosing. This is my way of making amends, thanking all those that helped me get to where I am today. However, there are many challenges involved in this. My record is currently in my way and stopping me from becoming an EMT. What us survivors have in common is the attitude that nothing is going to stop us. Even with these limitations on me, I have to tell you proudly that I saved my first life last week, the life of a 70-year-old man who was dead for over 20 minutes. I held his hand and felt his pulse come back. My dream is to become a firefighter as well as a nationally certified EMT. The reason why this bill needs to be passed is because I promise you that these struggles that I've told you about are the battles that every one of us victims of trafficking have to face. We are responsible for the decisions we make, but please consider the fact that we were taken against our will and that many of the things on our record, especially as a juvenile, were a direct result of our life circumstances. When we are ready to start our healing process, our criminal record is typically a very false representation of us. Our record is a barrier to us. It limits us from being able to obtain work, prevents us from being able to live in a safe neighborhood where we are not at risk to be re-victimized again. Please help the victims of trafficking to begin their lives anew. Help them to acquire a sense of self-worth and to be contributing members of our society. Thank you, Representative. Please vote yes on SB 67.
Thank you very much, Representative. Further remarks? Representative Rosen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Those remarks really don't need much for follow-up, but for those of us that were in committee and listened to this gal testify, she can go by her initials only because those pimps are like mafia. She really, they almost have to, it's like being in a witness protection program. But her testimony was so compelling, and I can hardly talk about it today. I mean, you really needed a good ball crying session afterwards. She's really pulled herself up by the bootstraps. She's a gal who, the epitome of the worst, broken home, alcoholism, violence, sexual predators, horrible. So she left because she ran away. Well, of course, truancy was the tag that she had, but got into a lot of trouble along the way, trying to be accepted, trying to make a living, trying to live on her own with no way to support herself. So this story was so compelling, and here she is today. I can't remember, clean for 8 months or 10 months, but wants to be an EMT. And you listen to her, and we need to help these girls. There's just, it's one of the most compelling stories. It's one of the things at Abbott House that we would like to do. We can't take all of them, and we don't have enough homes for the 18-year-olds once they hit there. So please support this bill. I think it's one of the most important bills that will pass this year.
Thank you, Representative. Further remarks? Further remarks? Seeing none, the question before the House is final passage of Senate Bill 67. Those in favor will vote yay. Those opposed, nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine. The members will proceed to vote. Steinhauer is excused.
Fred Mueller is aye. Dinner votes aye. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Clerk, will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there are yeas 66, excused 4.
Senate Bill 67, having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed correct.
Senate Bill 28, an act to make an appropriation for costs related to a suppression of wildfires in the state and to declare an emergency.
Senate Bill 28, having had a second reading, is up for consideration of final passage. This is a two-thirds vote requirement due to an appropriation and to declare an emergency. Are there any remarks? Representative Carson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Senate Bill 28 is to make an appropriation of the cost related to suppression of wildfires in the state of South Dakota and declare it an emergency. Appropriation from the general fund of $766,157. We see a bill like this each and every year. It is what we call a backfill. We do not know how many fires that are going to occur during the course of the year, so we paid the bill at the end of the year. The Legion Lake fire is not part of this bill this year. You will see that next year. Please vote green.
Thank you, Representative. Further remarks? Representative May.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Question for the sponsor.
State your question.
Can you give us a little more information on the history of the backfill, please?
Representative Carson, do you wish to answer that question?
Yes.
Thank you.
Several years ago, I've been appropriations 10 years. I would imagine it was under the Rounds administration. We were having a hard time with the budget. And along with that, we had a budget line item of $4 million. That we took out of the general fund and established it for the suppression of wildfires. So in doing so, at that particular year, we had about a $700,000, $800,000 bill. So we had the leftover $2.3 million, something of that nature. At that point in time, we decided that we would totally backfill all of the money and use that money to go ahead and balance the budget.
Thank you, Representative. Does that answer your question?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I think it does. I just want to make a point that I heard an analogy, and I have to share it. And it went like this. I don't go to the grocery store and give the $100 to buy milk in the future. So I'm a little concerned about these backfills and the money that we are putting aside, because we need to be, why are we not paying the bill when it comes in? Why are we putting all that money to the back for?
Representative Carson, do you wish to answer that question?
Yes. We're not putting the money in. We're not taking $100 out of the budget in case of the fire. What we used to, but what we're doing now is we're waiting for the fire bill to come in and then paying it.
Representative May, does that answer your question? Very good. Further remarks? Hearing no further remarks, question for the House is final passage of Senate Bill 28. Those in favor will vote yea, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote. And this is a two-thirds vote.
Beal votes aye. Oh, no, that's wrong. Excuse me, Beal is excused. Lust is aye. Dennard is aye. Framiola votes aye. Howard votes aye.
Nicholson excused.
Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were yeas 64, one nay, and excused 5.
Senate Bill 28, having received a majority of the two-thirds majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Are there any questions on the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed correct.
Senate Bill 45, an act to revise certain provisions regarding the sale of unclaimed property.
Senate Bill 45, having had its second readings up for consideration and final passage, are there any remarks? Representative Lake.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, members of the House. As you will recall, last year we passed legislation that changed how we manage certain assets that are turned over to the state as unclaimed property. Under last year's legislation, if a stock certificate is surrendered to the state of South Dakota, the treasurer was mandated to sell that stock within 90 days of its confirmed receipt. However, before the stock is sold, the governor's office, the Bureau of Finance and Management, and the state treasurer have put together a process that attempts to once again find the unclaimed property owner before the stock is liquidated. These include letters to the last known address and reaching out to alternative and social media. And as these processes have been put into place, especially when dealing with those that are in foreign countries, it has become apparent that 90 days is just not enough time to get this done. What Senate Bill 45 does is simply lengthens the mandatory sale time from 90 days to 180 days. This will help limit any potential exposure to legal action while allowing the treasurer ample time to contact potential owners of those properties. I would encourage your support of Senate Bill 45. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Lake. Further remarks? Further remarks on Senate Bill 45. Hearing no further remarks, the question before the House is final passage of Senate Bill 45. Those in favor will vote yea. Those opposed, nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Howard, aye. Frymuller, aye. Shane Fish, aye. Goodwin, aye. Marty, aye. Representative Consett. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were yeas 65, excused 5.
Senate Bill 45, having received a majority vote of the members elect, a two-thirds majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Oh, I'm sorry, that was a simple majority. Are there any questions on the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed correct.
Senate Bill 48, an act to authorize the Board of Regents to purchase improved agricultural real property in Meade County, to make an appropriation therefore, and to declare an emergency.
Representative Bartles.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This bill authorizes the Board of Regents and the South Dakota State University to purchase a little less than 112 acres of improved tillable property in Meade County, which will support the facility of agricultural research efforts conducted on the property. This will be their key piece of property in western South Dakota. The acquisition of this property replaces research and demonstration land that was previously rented near Wall and was lost, that they couldn't no longer lease it. There are improvements on the property that will further assist in the research efforts conducted, and it will enable research results to be more easily demonstrated to interested parties. The funds for this purchase will be funded from $502,461 proceeds from the SDSU Research Park payout.
and was received by SDSU in the fiscal year 17. And this is some land that was used for the research park that was ag experiment station land prior, and $400,000 in ag experiment station fees for services. This bill has an emergency clause to allow for the acquisition and possession this spring prior to the growing season. I'll stand by for questions.
Thank you, Representative Bartles. Senate Bill 48, any further remarks? Senate Bill 48, having had its second reading and having heard the remarks from the prime sponsor and seeing no further remarks, the question before the House is final passage of Senate Bill 48. Those in favor will vote yay, those opposed nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote. And this is a two-thirds vote due to the emergency clause and the appropriation.
Holmes votes aye. Representative Ring. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Clerk will please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were yeas 59, nays 8, excused 3.
Senate Bill 48, having received two-thirds majority vote of the members-elect, is hereby declared passed. Are there any questions on the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed correct.
Senate Bill 49, an act to authorize the Board of Regents to purchase unimproved agricultural real property in Brookings County and to make an appropriation therefor.
Senate Bill 49, having had its second readings up for consideration, final passage, are there any remarks? Representative Bartles.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I have an amendment at the desk.
Has it been distributed?
Yes, it has.
Do you wish to move it at this time?
Yes, I wish to move it.
Is there a second? Seconded? Are there any remarks on the motion?
Yes, Mr. Speaker. This is a motion to place an emergency clause in a new section on the bill, and I would hope that you would pass it. This is, should have been done in the Senate, and our good fellow senators missed it.
Any further remarks on the motion? And the motion that you're referencing is 49Z, as in zebra, A as in alpha?
Yes, Mr. Speaker.
Very good. Further remarks on the motion? Hearing no further remarks, the motion is to amend Senate Bill 49 with 49ZA. All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries.
Mr.
Further,
Speaker.
Further remarks on Senate Bill 49.
This equates Senate Bill 49 basically with Senate Bill 48. However, the land is located in Brookings. It's a little over 73 acres. And this will be replacing some land that the SDSU Agricultural Experiment Station has been renting. And it will be paid for by proceeds from the research park when it moved on to some of their property. And this property became available for sale, and the South Dakota Crop Improvement Association purchased it to partially replace the lost capacity, and we're buying it from them. And the emergency clause is to allow SDSU to own it prior to the crop season. I hope you'll all vote green. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Further remarks? Hearing no further remarks, and due to an appropriation as well as the amended emergency clause. The question before the House is final passage of Senate Bill 49 as amended. Those in favor will vote yay. Those opposed, nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
there. Straight down here.
Out there, yeah. Representative Weezy and Zickman. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there are yeas 60, nays 7, and excused 3.
Senate Bill 49, as amended, having received a two-thirds majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. Are there any questions on the title? Representative Bartles.
I have an amendment to the title at the desk, 49ZTA.
Has it been distributed?
Yes, Mr. Speaker.
And are you moving it at this time?
Yes, I'd like to move it.
Second it. Any comment on the motion to amend the title?
This title amendment is necessary due to the fact that we included the emergency clause in the bill.
Very good. Hearing no further remarks, the motion is to amend the title, which has been distributed. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. Motion carries.
The speaker signs House Bill 1034, an act to require certain insurance companies to identify and locate beneficiaries on life and annuity contracts. And the speaker signs Senate Bill 17, an act to revise certain provisions regarding a division under the Department of Human Services. Speaker signs Senate Bill 27, an act to make an appropriation from the Coordinated Natural Resources Conservation Fund to the State Conservation Commission. The speaker signs Senate Bill 40, an act to authorize the transfer of surplus real estate in Rapid City to the Ellsworth Development Authority and declare an emergency. Speaker also signs House Concurrent Resolution 1005, commending and recognizing the numerous contributions made by South Dakota social workers. The speaker signs Senate Concurrent Resolution Number 2, endorsing the right to work provisions in the South Dakota Constitution. And the speaker signs Senate Concurrent Resolution Number 2. Oh, I did that one twice. All right.
It's all yours. All right, thank you. Are there any announcements?
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Hunoff.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Trick question. What is the number one killer of South Dakotans?
True.
It's a non-working heart, heart disease and stroke. And since today is February 1st, we know it is now Heart Month. I see our speaker sort of has a red tie on. Want to remind you that tomorrow we want to celebrate the American Heart Month by wearing red. And those of you that are interested, there will be a group photo on the rotunda steps at 11:45. I said a non-working heart. I didn't say a loving heart. So keep your hearts in shape, and we'll see you tomorrow in red. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Further announcements? Representative Heineman.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Just a reminder, the Coalition for Tribal Economic Sovereignty is hosting a reception tonight. It's on your desk. Drifter's Bar at 5:30. Thank you.
Representative Roden.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House State Affairs, tomorrow morning, 7:45. Thank you.
Representative Johns.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Education meets 7:45. We have five bills on the docket.
Very good. Representative Rones.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Tomorrow morning, 10 a.m., House Commerce and Energy. We got five bills on the agenda tomorrow. Hopefully, we'll get rid of all of them. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Thanks to everybody for having a long day. Representative Ollers, do you have an announcement as well?
Yep. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Appropriations tomorrow morning, 8 o'clock. We have bill hearings.
Very good. And bear in mind that tomorrow is the last day for introduction of committee bills and joint resolutions. They must be at the front desk 2 hours prior to session. Any additional announcements? Representative Beal.
I move we adjourn.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay.
Aye.
Motion carries. We are adjourned.